All right, and we're here.
Wait, you do a clap.
What's up? It's DJ BABEYDREW, world-renowned Grammy Award-winning DJ, class of 2002, Hampton University, New Face Entertainment. I'm from Queens, New York. I'm in Atlanta, Georgia right now.
There you go. Cool. All right, so what made you decide to go to Hampton? How'd that happen?
One of my boys, I didn't have direction in life at that time, so one of my boys was like, I'm going to Hampton. And I was like, I'm going too. And that's how I went.
So no other options?
I applied for like 3 schools, but yeah. I didn't really. And then Hampton, of course, lost my paperwork. Yeah. So like when I went for high school day, I think I applied in like January. I went for high school day in like April.
Right.
And I got there and they were like, yeah, we never heard of you. I'm like, y'all accepted me. Like, what happened?
Right.
So like the guy went into the back office and just brought like an acceptance letter out. I was like, all right, cool. So I could have lied about that.
Right, right.
And I would have got in. So kids, if you want to get into college, just tell them they accepted you.
And they'll let you go.
And they'll let you go.
All right, so you get to Hampton. What was it like your freshman year? Everything was going on down there.
My freshman year was...
So was that like, that was 97?
That was 98.
98, okay.
That was, freshman year was a shock, a culture shock for me, because coming from New York, we're so straight, like, we just focus on one thing. But like, when you move to the South, you're learning about all this, like, for me, like, music that I never heard before. It was like go-go and Baltimore Club and like all the music from the South, like I didn't know about any of that stuff. So it was a crazy culture shock, and I embraced it because it was dope for me.
Cool. All right, let's talk about the old student center.
The best
grill.
Chicken tenders ever.
So, what was that like?
It was like a small little shack. It was cool though. It had vibes in there. It reminded me of. What's the show built with the Bill Cosby show spinoff with Hillman?
Different World.
It reminded me of A Different World. Exactly how A Different World was. That's how the grill was.
Okay.
It was cool. Cool place to get some junk food and just hang out and chill. We had parties in there too.
Right.
And the parties were cool. All
right. So then you came across, I guess, you know, my cousin, Laquan, and Howard's cousin, Femi.
Straight face.
Yeah. We were straight face. They were ever ready.
Oh,
ever,
right.
Ever ready,
okay.
And tenant. So, what was that like, I guess, you know, meeting them as college students and you guys hanging out, because not too many people have that perspective, you know, with those guys before we got there.
Honestly, I remember more hanging with you than I remember hanging with them. But like, I think I met them through New York pre-alumni, because they're from New York too.
Yeah, they're from New Rochelle and
I think that's how I met them, and I probably started working with you more than I worked with them.
Yeah, I mean, we definitely had a long-lasting friendship and relationship.
And then we threw our first party. We had our first Mardi Gras party.
That's right.
At Club Premier was actually a smaller spot next to the Legion.
Right.
You know, so what do you remember?
Damn, Club Premier.
Right.
I'm pretty sure people got shot in that club.
Yeah, like that was, you know.
Wow.
Yeah. The small spot next to the Legion. So what was that, I guess seeing me in my young days and, us, you being the big brother, the senior.
No, I always admired your work hustle and what you thought of outside of the box compared to everyone else your age. And you definitely had a sense of a business at a very young age that a lot of people don't have. So, not sure how you developed that, but I always looked up to you for that, and was like, this kid's gonna do something big in life.
Yeah, I remember. Just to fast forward real quick, I remember my senior year, we had to open for you, because remember I wasn't the DJ, I was like the mic man.
Yeah.
But then Sean was the DJ.
Right.
So when he was like, yo, I need you to open for me for. I forgot, what about one of the senior week events or something?
Right.
So like we're sitting there trying to get the crowd hype, and we're like, nobody was jacking us at all. Like they were not jacking our situation.
Right.
And you came on and was like, yo, go get a drink, get a couple drinks, get it warmed up. And it was like, all we had to do is tell them to get drunk. Like something simple like that, we didn't really think about doing. We were over trying to get people to the dance floor.
Yeah.
And then you came on like, it's like 11 o'clock. Nobody's gonna want to party yet. You got to get them going.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
It's a psychology thing.
Yeah. So we talked about the old student center.
Right.
And let's fast forward to the new student center now. So like you're coming back. Now you're alumni. And, it was a few times I got you to, go in the student center for the 12 to 2. What's the 12 to 2 like for you as a old Hampton alum?
12 to 2? First of all, they didn't allow us to do anything like that when I was younger at Hampton. So we were just like, how is this happening? Mm-hmm. It was just like a party in the middle of the day, 12 to 2, 2 hours of just crazy, just a whole room full of kids, literally like 1,000 kids during the lunchtime partying.
Mm-hmm.
Not many schools. I've not seen many schools that can do that.
Right.
Pull that off.
All right. So.
And the new student center was way better. It was just, it was beautiful. It was like, it was just massive compared to our student center.
Right.
Technology wise, it was way better. It was just beautiful. It was a beautiful building.
All right. So let's talk about the hustle.
All right.
The hustle, the grind that you went through, and then just give a little timeline from, you know, your freshman year going all the way to, you know, WHOV,
yeah,
102.1, and then how you ended up, you know, down here, you know, everything.
Right. Freshman, it's funny because I've been DJing since I was 12, but I didn't own equipment until sophomore year of Hampton. So okay. My freshman year, I didn't even own equipment, so I didn't have equipment with me. Mm-hmm. I bought equipment that summer, or my mom bought it for me that summer, so I was like, I had vinyl, but I didn't have a lot of vinyl, so I was collecting and just kind of spending all my money on vinyl.
Right.
And I remember I had to do sophomore junior cab, and at the time, I was thinking, I'm about to kill it, and I guess people were said it was good, but when I think back at it, it was terrible. Like, it was not good at all. So by the end of sophomore year, though, I collected enough vinyl to actually be able to do what it was that I needed to do. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because Hampton didn't embrace the DJs that were students.
Yeah.
They didn't. They really gave the gigs to like other people who did not go to school or Vince. And yeah. It was like, that makes no sense. Like, if we go to your school, why would you not embrace us for that side of entrepreneurship? And it is what we do. So I tell them that all the time today, because they always ask me to donate money, and I'm like, remember that time though? You didn't yeah. allow me to DJ. Mm-hmm. I mean, I still donate, but it's like, I'm making it a point to let them know that you need to support the students. It's like, that's, people make careers off this. I mean, mm-hmm. We make careers off this.
Right.
Oh yeah. So just really fighting the school administration. And I remember one time, me and Envy did a party in Ogden Hall, and after that party, they said they didn't want me to DJ in there anymore because I played curses. I know I didn't play curses, or I was saying curses on the mic. Mm-hmm. I was like, I never said any curses on the mic.
Right.
So like, it was just little things like that. It was like didn't make any sense. So I mean, by junior year, I was good. I was doing more stuff on the yard, and then I think there was a point where all the school stuff, that was the hard part that was a difficult part to get gigs for, but like all the parties you guys threw and all the other promotion companies, like it was easy for me to get those parties because the school didn't control it. So,
right.
And then I graduated in 02, actually, in 03, mm-hmm. December 03. I walked in 02, graduated in 03. Mm-hmm. I walked in 03.
Yeah.
I walked
yeah,
in 03.
You walked in 03, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so because I had an extra semester. Because I'm a slacker. It was just like one class, but it was cool. I was fine. I was like, I'm on the yard, I'm chilling. There's parties, there's girls, it's just whatever. So I stayed DJing Hampton parties till about probably 2006. Because mm-hmm. I remember I did one for you in 06, right?
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly. I don't remember from off the top of my head when exactly you left and you were coming back to DJ. But you were kind of off and on because then the Chris Brown thing and.
Yeah.
You were going back and forth a lot, but I was trying to pull you back for like Alpha Cabs.
Right.
Like, that was like my main. Right, I was like, if anything, you come back for, you know, for the Alpha Cabs. You know what I'm saying? So I want to say like it was somewhere around that time period you were going a lot of back and forth.
Yeah. But yeah, because I started commercial radio I think in 04,
and that was with
102.1. It was 04. It was a year after I graduated, and then 05 I started touring with Chris, and then. Yeah, so I would come back and do both.
I think the flyer that I have is 2006, and he was still fairly young. That's why the party flopped. Our party flopped, guys, because we tried to bring a 16-year-old to a college party, and
that no one knew.
Nobody knew because I think Run Tell That was the only song he had.
Run
It was the only song he had with Jewels, and it flopped. But you know,
it flopped really bad. I think was it partly because we didn't promote it right though. I mean,
no, I just think it flopped. Because at one point we were like, we should promote it to high school kids.
Right.
But it was after the concert, so high school kids would be home.
Right.
So like the only market we had really was the college students, and it flopped. A couple years later would have been good, but it flopped that
A couple
year.
Months later, actually.
Yeah.
If we did it 2 months later, because there was a moment where all of a sudden it went from 0 to 100, like quick.
Yeah.
So yeah, if we'd have waited a couple months, it was our timing, it was off.
Yeah. But I remember too, even that whole time period, because I, at this point now, I've graduated and I'm still doing the parties down there, and you were trying to get me to go on tour with y'all to book the after parties.
Right.
And like, me not thinking that far ahead, I didn't think like, let me just pack everything up and do it.
Right.
I stayed with the local thing, in my black hole.
Hampton. You would have been Chris Brown's manager by
then. Yeah, like, because that was when it was early. He was like, yo, listen, just come with us. All you gotta do is call the clubs. I remember he was like, call the clubs and book the spots at night while we're at the concert or during the day, and you'll be good. And I was like, but I'm making this bread in.
Right, right.
He was like, no, I'm telling you. I was like, nah, I'm good. Let me throw this Legion.
Right. Let me throw this Legion. Let me make a couple thousand real quick.
Right. But it was 2 points in my life. And I always tell everybody, it was 2 points. That was 1 point when I could have got up and go. And then the other point was when Tay got with Justin. And everyone got up and went to California. And I was like, nah, I'm just going to go back to New York. And I was like, I just didn't.
Yeah.
It didn't really trigger. But, all right. But, yeah, so you went from Chris, and then now you're down in Atlanta. So what do you do down here?
I'm still on radio. I'm never going to stop doing radio. So I'm on radio here, Power 96.1. Still DJ, still travel internationally a lot. I try not to go international as much anymore because I consolidate it into like 2 weeks at a time and then just do that. But
okay. Yeah. Any reason why?
Yeah, because kids.
Okay.
Be home with kids.
Yeah, for the most part.
So I DJ a lot here. I still DJ a lot out of town. I just kind of chilled on the international like that. And yeah, just I'm always gonna spin. Like when I'm in the nursing home with Kane, I'm gonna be spinning for the old people. Never gonna stop.
Gotcha. And since you brought it up real quick, so like we always talk to all the parents or within our business. So what is it like being a father, and what is it like for you to be raising young children?
Fatherhood is the greatest thing ever. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I feel bad leaving the house at night because little Drew will be like, "Where you going, Dad?" Hear like a tone in his voice, like, oh, but like, go to bed.
You should have been sleep already.
Right, you should
have been sleep
already.
But yeah. Alright.
Yeah, fatherhood's good. You should have a balance between, because there's some days where I'm spending like 3 gigs at a time, and like the next day I'm just done, like tired. So I gotta figure out how to balance. First of all, I gotta make them food in the morning. I gotta get up and make food. But like, you gotta figure out how to balance like just all that time. You gotta spend time with them too. Mm-hmm. So now we go, like, how people walk their dogs at night? I walk my kids at night. So we just like walk around the block every night. And just like sometimes we play basketball or we'll go to the playground or whatever.
Gotcha. All right. So you're a father, you're an entrepreneur, you're a businessman, you DJ. What else do you have going on? Anything else?
Always have something going on. I just started a trucking company. So I'm waiting on my first truck now. I got grandfathered into a situation where one of my friends has a really successful trucking company and he's helping me get mine off the ground. So my goal is to have like a fleet of trucks.
Okay.
So I can wake up and just put my feet up every day and just be like, chilling. I'm probably not going to do that, but
cool. All right, so going to HBCU and then DJing at different colleges, mm-hmm. Do you notice a difference between like going to black colleges and then going to like PWIs or
huge difference. Yeah. Huge difference. There's just different culture. It's just black colleges are just raw and turned. Well, I guess all colleges raw and turned up. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just different. It's like saying what's the difference between an orange and a grapefruit? Like it's just different. Like they're mm-hmm. both like good citrus fruits, but like that might be a bad analogy. I can't think of anything better. It's different. It's just different cultures. It's just different cultures.
Yeah. What do you think something like what we have with New Face, because if you remember, like, just on our level, like I said, we always try to make sure that you came back for the Alpha Cabs.
Right.
But we always worked every year for Homecoming consistently for about 5 or 6 years.
Right.
So to have that type of mentorship, what do you think that does for young college students that are trying to do something, like me and Tracy talked about, interning and having that type of person that you can look up to and learn from. What do you think that does for a young person trying to?
What do I think? What does?
Like having somebody like a big brother or somebody who's in the same industry.
Oh, okay,
yeah,
man.
Like I guess Envy. How many years old was Envy to you?
Two or three.
Yeah. So like just having somebody like a little bit older that you can.
Yeah. So my thing is, I have this thing that I have a few mantras in life. I have three mantras in life that I use. First mantra is, which has nothing to do with your question, but the third one does. The first one is, what's the worst that can happen? Mm-hmm. Right? Because that you can apply that to any situation. What's the worst that can happen? That you won't stress out. If you always think, what's the worst that can happen, you'll never be stressed. Mm-hmm. Second one is, I don't give up. Mm-hmm. So you apply mantra one, that didn't work, then I apply mantra two, what's the worst that can happen? Oh, well, I'm
gonna do it.
And then my third one is, your net worth is only a reflection of your net worth. Your net worth is a reflection of your network. So you cannot have net worth without a good network. So you always need somebody to look up to. You always need somebody to be, if you want to be a DJ, hang with other successful DJs. It's simple math. You want to be a lawyer, probably not a good idea to hang with like doctors or whatever. You know what I mean?
Hang with lawyers.
Right, hang with lawyers. So yeah, that's the answer to the question.
So what do you suggest otherwise besides going to college?
Network. And learn a skill and work hard, work your ass off on something. Be your own boss. Everyone's not built for that, so there's always a way though. There's always a way.
Anything else you wanted to say or anything you feel like would be worth it to the general public that
to the general public?
Yeah. To people who might end up watching this documentary. Anyone about yourself or
don't be lazy.
Yeah.
Work hard, work smart, and meet people. That's it.
Cool. All right, sir. Thank you very much for your
time. My man.
Appreciate it.